Welcome to Engineering Python. This is a Python programming course for engineers. In this video, I will talk about how to read and write text files. A file is a sequence of data that is stored in a computer. Files can contain any data types: music, pictures, videos, and text. We will only talk about text files in this video. A file usually contains more than one line of text. They are stored as multi-line strings. Python uses the new line character \n to mark line breaks. For example, after we print this string, we find that it contains multiple lines. The is in the first line. \n marks the end of the first line. Another \n marks the end of the second line. Because it has nothing other than \n, it is an empty line. Answer is in the third line. \n marks the end of the third line. Is42 period is on the last line. By the way, according to the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, 42 is the answer to the ultimate question of life, the universe, and everything, calculated by an enormous supercomputer named Deep Thought over a period of 7.5 million years. Enough with the science fiction stuff. Now let's see a real-world example. In the same folder of this Jupyter notebook, there is a file titled solar.txt. It contains some measured data of a solar PV array at Binghamton University. We can use this statement to open this file in Python. This is the file's name. This letter R means we open it in the reading mode only. We will not write any data back to this file. From now on, f represents the file object. f.read will read all the contents of this file as a single large string represented by data. After we read out the data, we use f.close to close the file. Let's show the data. Here is the output. Let's compare this output with a file opened in Notepad. The file shows that at 7 o'clock in the morning, the sun starts to come up. The power generation is 0.1 kilowatts. It gradually increases as the sun rises. It hits the peak at 2 o'clock in the afternoon and then decreases to zero at 9 o'clock at night. This is a long string with not only the time and power generation data, but also some special characters like \t and \n. We already talked about \n, which is a new line character. It marks the end of a line. \t is the tab character. We use the tab in each line to separate the time and the power generation data. It is good practice to use the with keyword when dealing with file objects. The advantage is that the file is properly closed after we finish using it, even if an exception is raised at some point. This statement opens the file solar.txt in the reading mode as f. In the body of the with statement, we read the file and give the content to variable data. Note we don't have to close the file by ourselves. It will be done automatically after this statement block is finished. In this line, we check to see if the file is properly closed. The answer is yes. Show the data. It is exactly the same as the previous example. f.read with a parameter size will read a specified number of characters from the current position. When size is omitted, the content of the entire file will be read. If the end of the file has been reached, f.read will return an empty string. Let's see an example. Open the solar.txt file in the reading mode. Next, read the first 8 characters starting with 1 from left in the file. This is the output. \t is counted as 1 character. So is \n. Read one more character from the current position. It is the letter M. Let's further read the rest of the file from the current position. It returns all the remaining characters. Read again. Because we already reached the end, this statement returns an empty string. After we are done, we close the file. Note this step is unnecessary if we use the with keyword to do all these operations. We can also read the file by lines instead of by characters. F.readLine is one of such functions. It reads the next line from the current position in the file. If the end of the file has been reached, it returns an empty string. As an example, let's open the file solar.txt in the reading mode using the with keyword. Let's read the first 5 lines using this for loop. Each time the loop is executed, we read just the next line and print this line to the screen. Because each line ends with the new line character \n, we don't want to show this character. We remove this character by setting end equals an empty string. This is the result, the first 5 lines of the file. A more efficient way of reading the entire file line by line is to directly loop through the file object f like this. There is no read or readLine function in this program, but it works nicely. We can also use listf and readLines to read all the lines of a file into a list, and then print out the line elements in the list using a loop. The results are exactly the same. So far we have been talking about how to read data from a file. Now we will talk about how to write data into a file. F.write string is a method that writes a string to the file. It returns the number of characters written. Be aware that if you open an existing file to write, you will overwrite the file's content. If the named file doesn't exist, a new file will be created. This program opens the file named myout.txt in the writing mode and gives it to the file object f. Because I don't have this file on my computer, it will create a new file with this name. Then it writes this multi-line string, the answer is 42, to this file. Finally, we close this file. After it's done, we should see this file in the same folder of this Jupyter notebook. We can open this file in Notepad and check its content. We can also use the with keyword to do the same. We don't have to manually close the file by ourselves in this case. The with statement will do that for us. The file has exactly the same content as in the previous example. After a file object is closed, either by a with statement or by calling f.close, attempts to use a file object will cause an error. See this example. We close the file first, then try to read from the file. The error says, IO operation on closed file. With all this basic knowledge of text files, now let's see an example. This example generates usernames in the batch mode, which is in contrast to the interactive mode. The batch mode means the input and output are done through files, and the program is not interacting with the user directly. The following program creates usernames for a computer system. The first and last names come from a file. We put the file processing code in the body of the with statement. We open realnames.txt in the reading mode as the input file. This file stores people's real first and last names. We also open usernames.txt in the writing mode as output file. The created usernames will go into this file. Note that there is a backslash at the end of this line, because this statement is too long if I show it in one line. I break it into two lines. This backslash means line continuation. Now let's process each line of the input file. We split each line into the first name and the last name. We create a username using the initial of the first name and the first 7 characters of the last name. Change the username to lowercase. When we print them out, we want to align them properly. The person's real name is writer justified, occupying space of 30 characters. The username is left justified, occupying the space of 10 characters. We remove the line break character \n from each line by excluding the last character. Finally, we write the username to the output file and add the line break \n to each line. Otherwise, the usernames will be shown in one line end to end. This is the output. The real names.txt actually contains the names of all the US presidents, from George Washington to Donald Trump. Donald Trump's username is dtrump. Barack Obama's user's name is bobama, and so on. Usernames are stored in usernames.txt. You can open this file and see the content in Notepad. Here is another example. This program calculates a student's cumulative grade point average, GPA. Assume the information of all the courses taken by the student is stored in a data file named courses.txt. This file contains comma-separated values. The first line is a header. This student has taken 5 courses already. Each row consists of a course ID, a course name, the credit hours, the corresponding letter grade for that course. We can use the following steps to calculate the cumulative GPA. Step 1, calculate the grade points of each course, which equals the letter grade times the credit hours. Each school may have their own letter grade system. We use the following letter grade system. A is equivalent to 4.0, A minus is equivalent to 3.7, and so on. Let's calculate the grade points for ISE 211, Engineering Economics. It has 4 credit hours, and the letter grade is B+, which is equivalent to 3.3. So 4 times 3.3 equals 13.2. We have to do it for all the other courses as well. Step 2, we need to calculate the total credit hours by adding all the credit hours in this column together. The result is 16. We also need to calculate the total grade points by adding all the grading points in this column together. The result is 58.3. Step 3, the cumulative GPA equals the total grade points divided by the total credits. For this student, it's 3.6 out of 4.0. Now let's implement this with Python. We first define a dictionary that contains the numerical equivalent of each letter grade. Then we initialize the total credit hours and the total grade points. They are set to 0. Next, we open courses.txt in the reading mode. Read and print the first line, which is the header. Then read all the remaining lines, which contain the detailed information for each course. Print the data to verify if the reading is done correctly. The result of the readLine function is a list with 5 elements. Each element is just one line. For each line in the list, we split it by comma and give the result to course. We get the credit for that course, which is the second element in the course list. The letter grade is the third element in the course list. We need to remove the leading space and the new line character \n using the strip method. Calculate the grade points GPS, which is the credit times the letter grade equivalent. Add this course credit to the total credit. Add this course grade points to the total grade points. Finally, calculate and print the cumulative GPA, which is total grade points divided by the total credits. Okay, I just talked about how to read and write text files in this video. The course materials are available on YouTube and GitHub. You can watch the course videos in sequence. If you like this video, please subscribe and share. I'm Yong Wang. Thanks for watching.